Friends, welcome back. This is part two of the Strong Life podcast with Joel Smith from Just Fly Sports. So part two of episode 253. If you haven't listened to part one, go back and listen. Joel outlined basically his training template of how he's training athletes. We spoke about his transition from college or, you know, different colleges and now back in a private sector. During interesting times with COVID, for those of you who will be listening down the road and come across this. So, Joel, one thing we were talking about when we broke down how you're organizing training for your athletes at this facility, we mentioned sprinting, we mentioned jumping, and something that's consistently on my mind, even mistakes I made in my early years, especially being overly influenced by certain coaches, and I think that happens to us a lot. We get caught up in strength. You know, you're a track guy, so maybe not so much for you, but we think, oh, if I just get this kid stronger, that will solve, you know, the world's problems. But the deeper I go into this field, Joel, and I'm sure with you too, you start hearing from many high-level coaches. They're like, yeah, I got stronger, but I didn't play better. I didn't get faster. So, and you also have your book, Speed Strength. So kind of what is the mistake going on that you've experienced or seen and even heard? I mean, you've interviewed a lot of unique coaches. They're not just, you interview a lot of unique coaches. So what have you seen or heard or experienced about when we need to put more focus outside of just lifting, you know, really modified powerlifting is what some of these programs look like. And I'm guilty in my early years of that as well, to get speed and athleticism.
Yeah. So it's a kind of a complex answer, because there's some areas where getting stronger absolutely is going to help you. Generally speaking, an athlete who has a good movement patterning underneath them, they've played enough and they've done, I guess you call it phys ed enough, and they just can move like a good human being.
Right.
You put strength on that athlete. And I've noticed this, especially on the serving as a strength coach on the university level. Some athletes come in and it's like, they're getting stronger and their times are getting better. And I'm not saying it's because of the strength, but something, I don't think that was hurting them. That was, I think, assisting them. We didn't do too much. And then some athletes would get stronger and just like, they weren't getting faster. They may have been getting slower. A lot of times in that case, the weight room actually was their outlet, because their times in the water weren't dropping, their times in the track weren't getting better. So, oh, well, I'll just grind harder in the weight room and that'll make it. And that's not how it works. I think that's the interesting thing. And I was just doing a podcast with Dan John, and we were having a very similar kind of conversation. Dan John, easy strength, something that's a little more like you're lifting heavy, but not hard, that ideology.
Love that book.
So I good. Love it. I have so many coaches who like always will pull back to that. And that was a game changer for me. And so I think that as soon as it becomes, well, I'm not fast enough, I'm not good enough at sport, let me make up for it in the weight room. I mean, again, there's not, I appreciate the hard work, that grinder kid, right? That
sure.
The maybe motivated everyone else through their hard work in the weight room. But those athletes who are the grinders in the weight room, who really just put their head down, a lot of times when they go to play their sport, you often see that grind show up. They're often impatient. They're too tunneled. So it's kind of like this balance that you always have to foster, where you're always like looking at maybe keeping things more open-ended. You look at mentality, look at their face, see what do I want to see on your face and your expression, mannerism when you're, again, maybe you are grinding for a set, but can you turn it off? Can you just turn it right back off when you need to and get back into this chill, open, mode. So maybe that's a more general thing. I don't know if you have anything to say with that, and I can go into more how that.
It just, you saying that reminded me of like an early, I think, I don't know if I had a conversation with Mike Guadango or it was the first podcast I did with him, but he was telling me, he's like, Zach, he's like, I barely even squat or deadlift with athletes. He's like, they show up. He's like, their bodies, they move so crappy. He's like, we sprint, we do the sleds, we do a lot of unilateral work. He's like, the way I train now is very similar. He's like, you hear what Mike Boyle talks about. He's like, that's very similar now versus heavy box squatting and so on and so forth. And I don't think people realize the power of sprinting, even if the athlete is not a field athlete. So I utilize sprints for all the athletes at the high school. We have a nice, not a steep incline, but it's like a nice gradual incline that forces them to really lift those knees and punch the foot and lift the toe up. I don't care if you wrestle, whether you're a field athlete or not. I've just found that sprinting to be so, you know, just so powerful. So also I've seen sometimes kids are just too big and you're like, man, for in long term, that kid could lose 40 pounds. But for now, let's try to lose, you know, a pound a week, 2 pounds a month. That could be 24 pounds in a year of losing fat. That could change your speed. So talk about sprinting. Let's talk about it for a non-field athlete who doesn't have to sprint. For example, swimmers, wrestlers, and then maybe get a little bit of like technical. That would be my downfall. And probably a lot of my listeners are also not sprint mechanic coaches. So I'd love to hear kind of the implementation of sprinting and then a little bit on the mechanical side.
Yeah. So we'll start with the implementation. And even if you don't know much about mechanics, like just putting gates out and just having athletes run as fast as they can through the gates, especially for a lot of our indoor facilities, it might be 10 or 20 meters. And on it, to be completely honest, and this is Dan Fichter said this a long time ago. It comes from Jay Schrader, is sometimes it's almost better not to say anything from technique.
Yes.
Because I would say this, and I guarantee me 10 years ago, 95% of what I would have told an athlete technically would have messed them up. Now, maybe I'm down to only 50% of what I say messing them up, you know, after all this years of learning and learning from a Darian Barr and just, you know, going through those things. I shouldn't say that, but I mean, I 50%, but I mean, I'm very careful what I say to an athlete to the point. And you can look at any track coach who's been in the game for a long time and they'll say every year, I say a little less, I say a little less, I say a little less, because I think we tend to like positions in the sense of we like to say, we see a knee up, a toe up, a tall posture, and we like to coach. This is maybe hopefully not getting the weeds too much, but we like to coach a position because it's easy. It's a concrete thing. I think the strength and conditioning industry is a very like concrete. Show me a number. Show me a position. Show me a data point. Show me something that we're doing. But when you get athletes too positionally oriented, sometimes it can take away from the movement quality that happens in between those frames, so to speak. So say the frame of maximal knee lift and the frame of toe off, by telling them to be in a position, you may impede on their ability to, for example, get pressure through their foot, drop their shin and divert force out the back. I'm not saying never coach a position. In fact, like I know like Alex Natera, a coach from Australia, will do maximal isometric pushes in sprint specific positions. Where there's a lot of force going into the ground. However, I just a general guy, I'll say nothing before I say anything. And I'm trying to hold myself back more and more. If you read the first chapter of Speed Strength, it kind of like bags on a lot of technical cues more than it gives solutions, which is, that's where I'm trying to like, I offer, you know, get a process that offers, I think, more over time. But it is the art of saying nothing. And I think that, and this is where we as strength coaches can excel for teaching sprint technique, is the technique actually comes from lift proficiency, in the sense of, can an athlete do a good lunge with a good torso position and have be in control and mastery of their shin angles or their back hip flexor mobility? If they have no body control in a lunge and I'm telling them to do stuff when they're sprinting, I'm pissing in the wind, man. It's just, you know,
it's
like
amazing. The lunge is such a powerful movement, yet the focus often is on your squat or clean.
Yeah.
You know what else I was thinking while you're talking about kind of the over coaching and just kind of waiting is, I also feel like 10 years ago, Joel, for example, we just had a session at my gym this morning and also yesterday, and I gave a younger kid feedback and he had tears in his eyes because I had to lower the box for box jumps. And I know he's a sensitive kid, so I'm always careful with that. Then a high school kid today, you know, we do like an open workout during the holidays. So they're maxing, going heavy. We don't do that often. That's very rare. But on these days, I let them. And so he pulled a deadlift and is, you know, was in a bad position, starting hunch, shoulders forward, and I'm pull back. Okay, go lighter. And as I'm trying to talk to him, you know, he's kind of like, you know, walking away versus stopping, listening. they sometimes kids today cannot handle you giving them a correction. Yeah. Do you feel like that maybe influenced your say less kind of stuff?
Yeah. So that's as I see it, there's a few different types of kids. There's kids who want to be corrected. If you look at individual personality types, those types are usually the high anxiety kids. You could generalize and say it's like the distance runners, more endurance athletes tend to be higher anxiety, but a higher anxiety athlete who is also craves structure. They need structure or they're going to get anxious. They are probably going to want you to tell them more, but that's where you have to be careful what you do tell them, because they are going to want it. They're going to be like, hey, you know, coach, what can I do there? What do I need? But if you give them too much, they're just going to become robots. And if you go to track meets and watch athletes warm up, you can see who the robots are, like people who are overdoing positions, basically overdoing sprint drills. And then they go run super rigid and get dusted by the guy or girl who did the real relaxed kind of dancing through their warm up. You know what I'm saying? Like they'll get dusted. And then you also do have athletes who don't want to hear anything. Like they're just like, just let me go. And to be honest though, those are the best athletes, like almost all the time. It's and if they have things that need to be cleaned up, really the best you can do is to just make a frame. Like let's say I have an athlete and let's just say they aren't getting enough knee lift, and that's debatable. I have some mentors who would say knee lift doesn't matter at all. I personally do sway towards let's just say an athlete doesn't lift out and they're huge out the backside, like feet are flying way behind them. What I might do with that athlete, and they don't want to hear anything from me. And if I guarantee, if I tell that athlete to lift their knees, they will not run faster. I have never in my entire history with my time in Gates ever had an athlete run faster one time by telling them that kind of cue in that situation. So what I might try to do is let's superset your running, or let's warm up for your running today with some general work that reinforces what I'm trying to see. So let's warm up with some lunges. And in the lunges, I want you to really focus on I'm going to make you put your hands on your hips and just pay attention to what your hips are doing. By that, I mean, if someone's like has those characteristics in their sprint, they might be tipping forward too much with their spine. They might be pointing their sternum down at the ground. You know what I'm saying? So if I can at least take them through some lunges, maybe some crossover lunges, some lateral lunges, and they're at least paying attention. And attention is an intention of where your energy and mental energy is directed in your body is underrated. If I'm directing my mental energy to my hips and my spine and my whole warm-up, hopefully that will work its way into the run. And hopefully I'll see that as a coach where that person, hopefully their technique changed and they don't even think I coached them into it. That's right. The ultimate. It's them. It's their power. I just gave you some exercises to learn a little bit more about your core and trunk and posture. And then you rolled with it. And maybe that changed your run a little bit, but again, and that's a more organic change than me saying something. But if I have an athlete who wants coaching, like tell me X, Y, Z, I'm still gonna, I've known coaches who will still not tell those athletes positions and it really frustrates them. So I would probably start with the least impeding, like, hey, why don't you pay attention to your posture, not so proximal stuff, not distal stuff. So I'd probably stay away from the hands and feet and knees and stuff. And I would just try to direct them towards awareness of what the more interior joints and things are doing, because that would allow them to hopefully to still flow through it a little bit better. That's just an example of how we'll navigate that between different types of athletes. I've had athletes all across the spectrum. Yes. I know a world, I worked with a 100-meter backstroker who is the female, or was the female world record holder for about a half a year or so. And she, like I've heard, like it was said, she's just uncoachable, but she was an amazing, she solved the problem in her own way and was a really good athlete. So
yeah, usually those higher level ones are eccentric in some shape or form. They might be very independent. They might be complete opposite, where they're like hovering around the coach to the extreme, right? Like practice is over, then they're in the coach's office just hanging out, hoping to hear something. Yeah, they're kind of all over the place. It kind of almost like, I don't know if I've maybe not dug deep enough, but from what I understood, you know, reading Charlie Francis's work, he would just say to run fast, you have to run fast. It's like, is that all? We're like, really, that's it? And then it's like, how are you running? And then I think people get caught up too. It's like, well, Ben Johnson did 600 pound squats, you know, half squats. So we should squat, you know, where he could bench 315, like, you know, no problem. They said he could bench 225 all day. You know, what were some You've probably dug deeper on Charlie Francis than I have, but was that like a big thing? Is he's just saying, run as fast as you can. When you're about to slow down or feel like you're not going to hit a PR, we're done for the day. That's very much like easy strength with Dan John. Like, you know, hit it hard and be done before you're done.
Yeah, that is important. That also is something. So with the Ben, well, first I'll actually go back because I wanted to mention this. Mike Boyle said this about just sprinting, and I wanted to cover this, is the idea that a lot of times in strength and conditioning, we'll see weight numbers go up and we'll see standing vertical jumps go up, which is more of a, I guess, quote unquote, muscular thing. It's more muscle than tendon. Just generalizing. It's like saying left brain, right brain. It always works together. But he would say that in the weight room, they get stronger and athletes' verticals will go up, but the sprint wouldn't go up unless they train the sprint. But the vertical can go up without training the vert if you get stronger. The sprint will not go up if you just get stronger, is what Mike had noticed. And I would say the same thing. The 10 yard, maybe it, you know, that I think can, but anything that's beyond 10, you're probably not going to see a huge change unless you train it. And then I'll say, if you train it, even without necessarily coaching it, just get athletes competing. And I find that is probably one of the biggest things.
Huge. That changes everything. Like, we do sleds every workout. We do it during the warm-up, then we do it after the workout. And I tell the kids, if you feel like you're not strong enough, do heavy sleds. If you want endurance, do 2 trips in a row. If you need speed, go lighter and go. And then if we do races, they're exhausted. I go, guys, we do sleds all the time. But when you compete, it's so different. It's very different. Same thing when I do those hill sprints with my high school athletes. We do some different starts, starting from different positions. Then we do the chasing the partner, try to tag the partner. Now everybody's running fast. Or if it's a race, that it just changes everything. And if the body's not used to that all out effort, then you're probably not going to be able to perform, you know, when you compete.
It's emotions. Sorry to cut you off.
No, what were you going to say?
Emotional state is highly underrated in the training. That's one of the biggest revelations of the last 5 years. And I've known it, but just to you will get 10% more if you can emotionally ready the athlete prior to whatever they're going to do. And so competition is usually the best way to do that. And also like a culture of competition, like record boards. Oh, you could set the record for this, like the bigger, faster, stronger, even where it's like your 5 rep record, your 10, it's massive. And so anyways, I was just going to say that culture is probably the most important thing. I value that with building speed more than like a technical mastery, to be honest, unless you're, you know, on the high level track and field and okay, now all these little hundredths are really going to, you know, now we really have to dissect this. But until you're, I think, a track athlete, putting that much mental energy into a lot of the technique, unless it's cerebral, can be counterproductive. And I really believe this, if you can do a good isometric lunge in a good position and sprint, and you can maintain and reference that type of position and posture, you're all right. You know, like, I mean, you can go beyond that for sure. And I certainly do. And I think it's good too, but going too far beyond, it's just like a lot of things where you start splitting hairs and just instead of leaving it up to the body.
I like it. One more question on speed, and then we're going to do our last question from there, Joel. So when I got back to the high school in mid-September and going back to when COVID shut everything down, we're looking at about 6 months, right? So mid-March to April, May, June, July, August, September, 6 months. And you saw it in the NFL. We saw a lot of injuries, but, you know, I'm going to look at the high school kids. You know, I think a lot of them did not train legs. You know, if they had stuff at home, they would bench and curl. And even aside from that, we probably see this in the beginning of a year anyway. We see, you know, they say, I pulled my hamstring. They don't understand. They're sore, or they've strained it, or they had, you know, quad strains. Well, you know, in general, why do certain people when sprinting, do they get that like hamstring pull? Is it from lack of hip mobility? What's the thing going on there? You know, especially I've seen it in adults. I remember one of the college wrestling coaches used to lift with us. And I remember whenever he would sprint, he would like pull his hamstring, you know, and he's like, ah. It was just, you know, so what's going on there? Is there a kind of a blanket thing happening, or is it 500 things happening wrong?
There's several. I conduct interviews, some interviews that occasionally get posted on the Simply Faster website. And one I did recently was a guy named Johan Lahti. He's from Finland. And a lot of the good hamstring research, like the holistic stuff where they look at every single factor, is coming out of Finland. And so a common question is, well, is it more running mechanics or is it strength? You know, do you just have weak hamstrings, right? And those types of things. And so the thing is, or there's it mobility or whatever, like there's tons of different type of equations. So I guess I'll just go through each of like kind of the factors and just give a little bit. So first I'll say the mobility, like, oh, you're not flexible enough. Well, here's an interesting thing that they found. Less flexible people do have more hamstring pulls, but
flexible where though?
I think it like hips and hamstrings, like probably okay. I imagine like a hamstring stretch test and hip flexors. I don't know the exact one. So if you look up, if you go to Simply Faster and check out Johan Lahti, Johan, and then Lahti, I think he talked about that in there and you could probably get to that research.
Okay.
But here was the interesting thing is they also found that that doing a static stretching program to try to get on that level for athletes who were deficient did not help the prevention. So that gets into, well, why are we flexible? If we stretch to do it versus, and I look at an athlete who is flexible it's not just because they stretch. A lot of athletes are flexible without stretching. And you could say maybe they have more fast twitch muscle, which tends to be more loose than slow twitch muscle. It's the way their muscles and tendons naturally interact. Maybe they're just emotionally like more chill because people right. are really uptight, you know, they're, so there's a lot of factors with that stuff. And so I think people like reductionist answers. Oh, just stretch. Well, it's more complicated. And that's where I'll say my meat in the middle is loaded stretching, weighted stretching type stuff. Like even like an extreme iso lunge or where you hold some weights or like a loaded hamstring stretch, stuff like that. I think you can't go wrong. So that's something I'll say with there. Strength is an interesting one. I've seen... This is where you just get so much stuff, man. Like I've seen people swear by, you know, glute hamstrings as instructed by Michael Yeses to reduce hamstring rates. And I've also seen coaches who say the glute ham is terrible for hamstrings. You need to be looking at the foot and the heel and the calcaneus and upstream from the ground instead. So it's like, man, what do you even look at? And so for me, J.B. Morin, who's a French researcher, has said this, there's a lot of really strong hamstrings that get torn. And so, cause you could even say a strong, just like, an athlete with a strong back, maybe overusing their back, like in all their lifts, you know what I'm saying? Oh, I just hinge everything and my back is yoked. I've been there. You could also say the athlete with a really strong hamstring just overuses their hamstring cause of poor biomechanical chain. So all I'll say to that is I've used the Nordic hamstring in a microdose, like my big problem athletes with hamstrings, I've really found a good solution there by one, just kind of regulating, finding those key workouts that would be triggering to the hammy, and then microdosing Nordic hamstrings, doing like just two sets of three every single day, two sets of two every single day seemed to be helpful.
That's nothing.
Yeah. It seems like nothing, but if you do a really good Nordic, it's like, that's
pretty. How do you do the Nordic with the partner, or do you have like a roller pad where they're locked in?
Oh, it doesn't matter. Either hold the heels down or lock in on the roller pad. A lot of people aren't strong enough to do a good one because they'll go about, you know, 20 degrees and then they can't take it anymore.
Stick their butt back. Yeah.
Yes, exactly. So they usually need like a band. I like a band a little bit more, but you could use a roller in front to, there's a lot of ways to do it. So I've had some luck microdosing Nordic hamstrings, just keeping it simple like that. I think that's, but there has been research too that only works. It's almost like it doesn't really work the muscles. Nothing works the muscles of the hamstring exactly like sprinting does. Nothing. Nothing in the weight room. Cause it's kind of ass backwards, to be honest, with the weight room and then actually going in open chain, like running. It's just that we can't replicate it. So, but I think that's a decent one. And then running mechanics. If you listen to a lot of the guys out there, they'll just say, and I do agree with this, is the to a point, is that having like a real high backside mechanic where you're kind of kicking yourself in the butt does seem to correlate with hamstring pulls. And I would agree. But I will say this, is that the timing is also underrated. So, well, one, I think that becomes an excuse for people to say, oh, well, let's just get around running high knees and then they're going to be great. No one runs in a game with high knees. Like video any game ever, And it is extremely rare to see someone running with a true high knee like type motion, or let alone how even track sprinters kind of run. It's generally a little bit lower knee because they have to be ready to change directions and all that stuff. So for me, I would focus just more on pelvic posture. If someone's stuck in anterior tilt and that's causing like a lot of butt kicking, just you giving exercises to control the pelvis. But the big one, you'll see where the pulls happen is where there's a timing mismatch. So with when the foot's in the backside of the body, like you just pushed into the ground or you rolled through the ground and your leg's coming up behind you, the arm on the contralateral side, I get a little dyslexic sometimes. So the opposite side of the body. So if my left leg is behind me and my my left leg's behind me and my right arm is both behind me, those should both start coming to the front side of the body at the same time. Okay, so when the left leg is behind me, I just pushed off and now my right arm is behind me. They're together. They're synced up. If the leg starts coming forward before the arm, or the arm starts coming forward before the leg, that subtle timing mismatch is actually where a lot of stuff happens. And so when athletes get tired, they get fatigued, that timing can fall off. And so for me, yeah, mechanics is huge, but to me, it's almost like a good athlete, even with quote unquote bad mechanics, can kind of keep that timing together. Like they're just good enough of an athlete to have that coordination under fatigues. And so they can get away with stuff that you might say is bad.
Yeah.
That's a little more anecdotal. There's not research on that. So take that for what it's worth. There is research on some of the other things that I was talking about, if you want to go down that route, but I would just invite people to look at their athletes, the timing of the arms and the legs. And I think athletes who have bad, just arm leg timing tend to be more susceptible. So just having good timing with that and emphasizing that can be helpful.
Yeah. A lot of this stuff just, it's like pieces of the puzzle, and just thinking, I'd love to reconnect with you in the middle of football season to hear how you're training your football players, you know, because you have that 5-day a week program. Now they're running 5 days a week. Their sixth day is film. They usually do film. If they play on Fridays, they do film on Saturday. It'll be interesting to hear what changes you make to their training.
Yeah.
In season.
I'm always a less is more guy. So yep. I can definitely tell you that.
Yeah. Easy strength. So let's close this out, Joel. Let's talk about something, you know, you and I have both been at college sector, private, you do consulting, your podcast has coaches from all around the world. And Brett Bartholomew, you stated something some months ago. I don't know what if he sat with Dana White or I think he ran into Dana White, you know, UFC president, and Dana was like, hey, what do you do? It's like, oh, I'm a strength and conditioning coach. He's like, man, that is the weirdest profession where you guys are always putting down somebody else in your profession. And I remember Brett was like, man, it was embarrassing to like, that's his first kind of like, that's the first thing he knows about us as strength and conditioning coaches. And in our field, sometimes we have coaches that are very polarizing. They always make statements that are completely against something else versus just being like, well, kind of what you were saying. You're like, look, here's some things that I know. They're not absolutes. Sometimes it works. Sometimes it doesn't. You know, my favorite answer for questions on strength and conditioning is it depends, you know, give me the context. So, you know, I sometimes see that where a coach has to put down another coach publicly or make statements that are polarizing. You know, you've been at the college sector, you see what's happening. And I think that works against us. So what are just some random thoughts you have on this strength coach profession, being a professional?
Yeah. So I'm glad you asked that. One of the things, and I had to think about that with kind of everything. One of the things I've been thinking about lately is just my own biases in pretty much everything, not just like strength and conditioning, but what do I believe about things that are going on in the country and the world? And I'm always like double checking my own thought process. Cause I'm like, okay, my gut says this, but we always rationalize around what our gut says. And I'm just always trying to check myself. And so I have always been really open-minded, but there is kind of I would say you have to be careful when you're open-minded, because I always don't want to steer people in the wrong direction. I don't just want to say, hey, this is what I'm into now. Everyone abandon everything else.
Correct.
And so I'm very cognizant of that. But I think one of the things that I try to do personally is just put myself in the other person's shoes. And so whether you're, I've heard that saying in the context of a debate, if you are trying to be right, which that's one thing, is I think that it's better to be kind than to be right. And I think we are an industry that needs to be right. We find the need to be right very desperately. I think that's not just this industry, but for some reason I think it's pretty prevalent. I don't even get on social media. I don't talk on social media. I wish we could all go back to those forums. Even then people would still yell at each other, but it's just everything changed because the audiences got bigger and perception. Right. I didn't know where I was going with some of that, but I'll say this. I feel like the strength and conditioning industry and this, the coaching, we got into this because we were competitive, right? Like we were competitive. I think that there also comes, and this, I think this is important to say, is a lot of times people will try to construct a psyche, a validation, a sense of worth, because I'll say this, getting strong is awesome for your confidence. I fully believe in that. But some people take that so far, they wrap everything up in that. You wrap your validation up in, like you're insecure and you're going to band-aid over it by building your body to something. And so I think that this, the competitive nature of who we are as sport coaches, sometimes this like almost your training is you type mentality, I think that that can filter into the same thing that we might see in the industry. I don't think it's everybody. I think it's some people. There's a lot of really good people in our industry. I love
great people.
Yeah. And so I think sometimes we talk about this like divisiveness. I will say, like, I think it's an industry that does need to move forward badly, but it's an industry with a lot of really good people too. People who are like really trying to help youth training, especially. There's so many good people trying to like make such a good cause in youth training and you also look at some of the coaches out there. I know you had Kurt Hester recently on your podcast.
Love
and
that
I
just guy.
Can't think of like, I'm like, man, if I was going to have any strength coach in college, like you can't almost think of a better dude to lead that, like really the heart of your athletes than that guy. And so
yeah,
I just, I guess what I'll say is I just think that sometimes we forget who we really are because we're trying to be right. And we're trying to be right with something that we validated ourselves with,
which is our
strength level.
It's okay to be wrong. You know, you said it before about these athletes that are difficult to coach. Some of the kids I struggled to coach are now more in touch with me now that I'm not in the university with them, because it's freedom for them. And I look back and realize I was wrong. You know, we train at 8, 9 a.m. That's what we do. Well, what if it's a fifth year senior who's exhausted? He needs to sleep till 10 a.m., right? His body's got a lot more mileage. And, you know, so there's so much learning we could do. And you're right. There are amazing people. And ironically, when you mentioned Kurt, I remember when I reached out to Kurt saying, Kurt, what's like the best speed book you're reading? And he mentioned your book. And it's funny. I swear to you, I was thinking that like 30 seconds before you brought up his name. And when you mentioned Kurt being for the kids, I remember Kurt said to me, Zach, you could call me or text me anytime. He's like, my phone is always on in case a kid has to call me at 4 a.m. That's what he said to me. Yeah. And it's like, wow, he's just about the kids. And I forget that he's in his mid to late 50s. Mm-hmm. I sometimes think he's like 37, you know, I forget, like, cause he's so young and got this energy about him. And his book, I recommend it to all strength coaches because he is willing to get fired for doing the right thing for the kids. And he really, I didn't realize his book was going to be so much about like career choices. And when I read it, I was like, whoa, every strength coach has to read this. But I like what you're saying about just, you got to be open-minded. I know that what's interesting in my earlier years of being on the internet, Joel, because of the underground strength coach and using sandbags and this or that, like a buddy of mine told me, he's like, Zach, back then nobody was doing that. He's like, and that's why you had this rabid following, because it was kind of, not that I was trying to polarize, but people saw it as an extreme and they got into that. And I think, you know, the people out there that are like, yeah, if you're not strong, you know, you're a loser, or if you're not sprinting, you're a loser, right? Whatever is being said out there, that like people flock to that. And then those people do more of it. I think what's really cool is the guy that wrote the article for you on the zombie apocalypse. What's his name again?
Oh, Austin Yoakam.
Yeah, he said he was talking about wishing he got into coaching before he had his CSCS, before he had his degree. So he wasn't showing up with preconceived notions about how to train, you know, versus building athletes. And I think we need more of that, you know, like this month I'm looking at us and we need more strength, more power. But then next month I might be looking at what's going on and I might feel like, you know what? We probably don't need to touch a barbell for the next 2 or 3 weeks. We got to reclaim athleticism, get out, you know, like my mind moves like a chameleon. And not that that is right or wrong. But whatever I'm doing, I never feel like I need to put down another coach. And I think like for any coaches out there listening, if they're ever like about to do that, you know, just keep that stuff private or have a private conversation with somebody about it. Your social media presence, I think what's good to state is, Joel, you were hired from a phone call. You got hired from a job you never applied for. Same with me at both universities. I never applied. I was invited to come and train a group of guys. Then the other guy saw all the stuff I did online. What if they see you online all the time putting down people? Who's going to call you now, right? And I think that's important because you never know what direction your career or profession is going to take. Like, for example, you know, I've been thinking a lot the past few months and maybe past few years of like, man, as a strength coach, our influence might hit a ceiling unless you become an administrator. Mm-hmm. Right. And now I can start saying, listen, we just invested in this weight room, $3 million. We shouldn't be paying a coach $50,000, right? We should value people, not just the things. And so I start seeing like, what if my social media presence is all like negative and slandering people? Who's going to hire me to be an administrator now? So be ready for, you know, be prepared to evolve. And like, is this thing that you're sharing, is it going to be good 3 or 5 years from now? I think that's a kind of like what you said, like be careful before you just what's on your heart or your gut instinct. Don't put that out right away.
Yeah. I think people are very reactive based off of, I've heard it said, like I'm reading a book by Jonathan Haidt called The Righteous Mind. It's why good people are divided by politics and religion. And it's the first chapter was heavy, man. Like I had to slog, but then like, it's been real good. It talks about the mind as a horse. It's like, our minds is like a rider riding an elephant, and the elephant is like our gut instinct, you know, and it wants to, and the rider's trying to control this thing. And yeah, I just think that at the end of the day, like people who are, I try to always think about this, people who are throwing fire, so to speak, who are not acting professionally, there's a hurt. They're acting out of a hurt. And so I always feel like on the inside, they maybe something from their childhood or something that they've just always come up with. And so for me, I always try to look at those people from those eyes. And again, but that's why I just try not to put myself in a position to get triggered or whatever on social media. But I always try to put myself in that person's shoes as best I can. And
that's good. Yeah. You heard that quote, hurt people, hurt people. Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's kind of like what you're saying. People have told me, they're like, Zach, your information is very level-headed. They're like, that's why you're not getting, you know, all these crazy views on your YouTube. I'm like, yeah, but that's how I think now. I'm level-headed. I'm not extreme like I was in my mid to late 20s about the intensity and this and that. So, and I'm okay with that because then I could go to bed at night feeling good about what I put out, you know?
Yeah. So, well, I think a big part of me would have liked to train with you back in those early days. I would have. If I could go in a time machine, you'd be one of those tops. So.
Oh man. You know, I always say that the best, I don't want to say the best training, but the great training was when I was out of the first, not my parents' garage, but the first house we bought because of the freedom that we had of a little bit in the garage. So that was the strength and power work. Then the backyard and the open field was all the athleticism, the power, the endurance, the grit and toughness building. And even like yesterday, two kids started wrestling each other. They don't even wrestle. They started wrestling on the turf, which is never good, right? You get turf burn. Like it looked like a scene out of Braveheart, like blood on their faces. But it was like, okay, those guys needed to compete. They decided to wrestle themselves. I don't push that on anybody. But yeah, we would wrestle on the grass back in those days, or we push my truck across a long parking lot, sprinting hills, and also training in the elements. It was sometimes very hot in the summer, right? Or very cold, you know? And those elements made our kids better. All that kind of, it was a lot of pieces of a puzzle. I do think, Joel, like I will eventually have that barn where I can kind of recreate that, where we could train inside. And then outside, I've got some monkey bars built up. And then there's a field and a hill for sprinting and jumping and free movement, throwing medicine balls without worrying, is this going to hit the wall or the ceiling? That stuff was so powerful. I wasn't the best at things with like programming, but I think just putting a lot of good things together was, you know, that was the ticket. So yeah, back in the day, buddy.
I bet those kids were so mentally and emotionally into it. Like I mentioned before, that was probably like there, like you said, even if your program wasn't on point, dude.
That was the best. Those kids were, they did not start as the best, but they became some of the best because of their, what it did for their performance. And then when I got the first warehouse facility, I noticed an immediate and dramatic like decline because of not going to the hills to sprint or pushing my truck. And, you know, we had two sleds and now there's five people waiting for a sled. Back then there was no waiting, you know, two guys were on a sled. Another guy was pushing my truck. Two guys were sprinting a hill. Somebody else was sprinting across the parking lot to get to the playground to do pull-ups and press the picnic table. So it was just like this working thing. And I wasn't at the time being like, you're a football player, like rest 3 minutes. I wasn't thinking like that. We were just working. And I think that's what made those football players better, because they were in great shape. They were in great shape back in the day, bro. So listen, this has been awesome. This is the end of part two. Let's give our listeners, you know, I'm a big follower and listener of your podcast, but you also have a lot of articles. So your website is just-fly-sports, and same thing with the podcast. And then you've got the book Speed Strength. Where is the book only available on Amazon, Joel?
It's on my website. So preferentially, of course, you know, the small business side of me, get it from my website, because Amazon takes a cut, but you can get it on Amazon too. And it's also on, for people in like India and Australia and all these countries hard to ship to, I get it. There's a Kindle version as well. So you can get it either of those places.
Good. What's anything you want to talk about before we close out here? Or, you know, you do consulting. Who normally consults with you?
Yeah. Usually it's just, for the most part, I do like online training, but also with the consulting, pretty much just anybody who wants to learn more about their, you know, their performance and what they're trying to get better at. So I have a lot of athletes in their like 20s, 30s, even 60s. You know, I'm consulting right now with a master's pole vaulter, 68. So pretty much anyone who wants to get better, learn about something, I'll do consulting with. So.
Right. And where are you in Ohio? Cincinnati?
Yeah, Cincinnati.
Very cool. So, you know, now that you're in, really, that's like, there's a lot of pro sport teams. It would be cool to hear about the first pro sport team that calls you up for a consulting day.
Yeah. Yeah. I have talked with a few coaches and consulted coaches in the pro sports, but never a formally like, you know, this team is consulting, but I hope for that to happen soon. Yeah. That'll be,
I'm going to introduce you to my buddy who's in Ohio. He's working with one of the pro teams. And then actually one of the kids we train, his dad is with the, where are the Bengals? Bengals are in
Cincinnati. Yeah. Not too far from where I'm at.
Okay, very cool. I'm gonna make a connection with you guys. I'm actually gonna text you when we hang up. I want to thank everybody for listening to the Strong Life podcast. Check out my buddy Joel. Also, we did some stuff where he was kind of like demonstrating technique stuff, talking about it. So make sure you watch it on YouTube. Don't just listen. And go to Joel's website, dig in, tons of stuff to learn. One of my favorite podcasts. I love your enthusiasm from learning from people. You could just tell that you get like hyped up from like learning from somebody. So I love it. So Joel, happy new year. Happy new year to everybody listening. Let's crush 2022. Joel, just hang tight while I shut it down and stop recording.